This is a U-Haul truck in Ontario, Canada. As you can see, the truck was registered in Arizona. Now, that might make you think that the owner is moving from Arizona to Ontario, but I know that that's not true for three reasons. One, no one would ever move from Arizona to Ontario. Arizona has 15 Waffle Houses and Ontario has 0 Waffle Houses. Two, I photoshopped this image because I couldn't find a photo of a U-Haul truck in Ontario. And three, every single U-Haul is registered in Arizona. Or at least every single U-Haul in this general area. Not Hawaii or Alaska because Hawaii is far away and Alaska doesn't have roads. This imaginary person could have been moving from one Canadian province to another, and their U-Haul would still have an Arizona plate on it. So, why? Well, the answer to why Arizona is a pretty simple one. It's where U-Haul is headquartered. They register their trucks in Arizona, because they gotta register them somewhere, and then send them out to where they need to go, at least within the contiguous United States or Canada. But that answer kind of sucks, and it doesn't really get at what's interesting about this subject. If you take a look at our interesting meter, we're only at 7% as interesting, and we owe you a whole half as interesting. So we should ask a slightly more complicated question. Why did U-Haul move their headquarters to Arizona in the first place? Why do all those Arizona plates say apportioned on them? And how are these trucks allowed to be rented and used in Canada when they've only been registered in Arizona? To answer that question with all of its big words and extra clauses, we need a better understanding of how the vehicle registration system in the United States actually works. You see, our registration system, or really our 50 different registration systems, weren't really designed around cars traveling as far as they do these days. In fact, the first license plates, which were mandated in New York in 1901, were literally just whatever your initials were. You'd see a car cruising down the street and think, oh look, that car belongs to Jeff, one of like 4 guys who owns a car. I'd better phone the police and tell them that he's driving 17 miles an hour and should be arrested for speeding. And this worked okay because cars used to be powered by vinegar or whatever and couldn't really travel outside their local community, let alone their state or country. But even as vehicle registration became more common and a little more sophisticated than painting 2 letters on your car, it was still a pretty local thing. Trains were the main mode of long-distance shipping and transportation, whereas trucks tended to stay confined to cities in whatever state they were registered in. But then the best thing to ever happen to the trucking industry finally happened. Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir presumptive to the throne of Austria-Hungary, was assassinated. Okay, I promise that this video is still about why U-Hauls are all registered in Arizona. Let's just fast forward a bit. Yada yada yada, World War I happens, blah blah, the US declares war on Germany, bang bang boom, American freight trains become overloaded, and voila! We finally need a new system for transporting goods across state lines. Long-haul trucking is suddenly a thing, FDR makes some plans to build an interstate highway system, we put those plans on hold because of this guy kills himself and we can finally build the highways, and uh-oh, it turns out that having dozens of different vehicle registration systems crammed into one country is a massive problem. You see, any kind of commercial vehicle, like a truck or a bus or my failed business idea of a mobile escape room, needs to be registered in each state that it's doing business in. For decades, that meant that any truck that wanted to cross state lines needed a separate license plate for every single state it was going to pass through, and needed to pay separate registration fees every single year in every single one of those states. Needless to say, this was bad. There were some half-baked solutions to this problem like bingo boards, which were essentially just license plates with a bunch of mini license plates on them from different states, but that only solved the problem of running out of theoretical license plate space. You still had to deal with the headache of registering your truck in all of those states, and you still had to pay separate annual fees to each of them. That finally began to change in the tumultuous year of 1968. The Civil Rights Act was passed, JFK was assassinated, and the American Association of Motor Vehicle Administrators formed a subcommittee to create a comprehensive plan for efficient interstate commerce. For some reason, you never hear about that third one, but it was a big freaking deal. Essentially, it produced an agreement between states. Originally these ones, but eventually also these ones, plus these bonus Canadian ones because Canada was feeling left out, to share registration fees. Under this new plan, a commercial vehicle only needed to register in a single state or province with a special apportioned plate. That's what the apportioned thing is about, by the way. And the annual registration fees on that vehicle would be split, based on total distance, between all of the different jurisdictions that the vehicle drove through. That's why you'll see these plates on U-Hauls, trucks, interstate buses, anything like that. But weirdly, this doesn't apply to rental cars because apportioned vehicles have to be really heavy or at least have a bunch of extra wheels. As for why U-Haul chose to do this through Arizona instead of any other states, well, it's because their license plates have fun little cacti on them. Or maybe it's because Arizona's laws let them register their trucks permanently with really low rates and no safety inspections whatsoever. Who knows? All I know is that groceries have gotten really darn expensive lately. But luckily for you, I have a solution. HelloFresh. I've been using HelloFresh for years now, and they have saved me countless hours of time, countless dollars of money, and countless, whatever unit they use to measure stress. Instead of wasting money on takeout or overpriced groceries that end up going bad in my fridge, I get to choose from dozens of meals every single week and get the exact ingredients, perfectly proportioned, delivered right to my doorstep. For example, this week I had one of my favorite dishes, the firecracker meatballs. I mean, just look for yourself. It was honestly really good. The meals are delicious and super easy to make in usually under 30 minutes, even if you're totally intimidated by cooking. But best of all, you'll be reducing your carbon footprint by cutting your food waste down to nearly nothing. No more expired ingredients or halves of onions getting tossed in the trash. If you want to try HelloFresh, I can't recommend it enough. It's super easy to sign up. Just go to HelloFresh.com and use code HI16 for up to 16 free meals and 3 surprise gifts.